We encourage children to memorize the Word of God, which is good. Of course, we are called to do that. And I'm glad that every church has that curriculum or that policy in their churches that they are helping kids to keep God's Word in their heart. But my question tonight is, why are we not doing that when we become the elders? Why did we stop keeping God's Word? Why did we stop memorizing the Scriptures? Yes, we were taught to keep God's Word in our hearts while we went to Sunday school. We forced our children to memorize God's Word. But why did we stop memorizing the Scriptures when we are grown up? Have you ever thought of that? Some way the devil has blinded us. Some way the old serpent has blinded us. But to get victory over that, we need to smite the Word of God on the ground. Smite the arrows upon the ground to see the revival. Which arrows we should smite? On which ground we should smite? That's the topic. Whenever the enemies used to come, God used to tell to his prophet what the king has to do and how he has to prepare for the battle. So Elijah was so successful in telling the kings what the God's plans are when there was battle. Many times Syrians came for the battle, and Elisha was telling the king of Israel what to do and what not to do. But now we see a situation where the king saying, verse 14, now Elisha was fallen sick of his sickness, whereof he died, and Joash the king of Israel came down unto him and wept over his face and said, O my father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. And we see seven spiritual truths here. If we can apply these truths to our spiritual life, we can see revival. Because now the king of Israel, the people of Israel, in a state where the prophet is dying. If that prophet dies, they don't know how to battle against Syrians, against their enemies. Yes, in Christ we don't have physical enemies, but we do have spiritual enemies. The first one is world. We are fighting against world. And the second enemy is our world nature. We always have problems with our old nature. And the third enemy is old serpent. In the book of Revelation, it says that Satan is an old serpent. So we have three main enemies. The first enemy is the world which we are living in. And the second enemy is our own old nature. And the third enemy is old serpent, Satan, the devil. We always fight with these three enemies, and many times we fail to get victory over these things. And that's the reason we don't see revival in our lives, because every time we struggle to get victory over these things. Some people may fall in the world. Some people may fall to their own world flesh desires. Some people may fall to the old serpent, the devil, the Satan. But here is a perfect plan that God is giving to the king of Israel through the prophet Elisha what he should be doing. So the first thing, the first spiritual lesson that we learn here is, if we read verse 15, here the prophet Elijah is telling, And Elisha said unto him, take bow and arrows. And he took unto him bow and arrows. So the first thing the prophet Elisha is telling to the king of Israel is, you have to take the bow and the arrow. And the king has taken that bow and the arrow. What is that bow that we have to take? What is that arrow that we have to take? And the bow is the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And the arrows are the word of God. If you want to see revival in your life, if you want to have victory over the world or the world-worn flesh or the world serpent, you must take the bow and the arrow. And that bow is the Holy Spirit. And that arrows are the words of God. Are we having the bow? Are we having the arrows, the words of God with us? Because it is the Holy Spirit and it is the word of God that gives us victory to overcome this world and the world nature and the world serpent. Just remember how you got saved. It is amazing to see how God has saved us. And Titus chapter 3 verse 5 says how we are saved. Here the word of God says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy we are saved by the washing of regeneration and by renewing of the Holy Ghost. God is using the Holy Spirit right at the beginning of our salvation. 1 Peter chapter 1 verses 23 says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, of the incorruptible seed, the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. So we see both the Holy Spirit and the word of God right at our salvation. These two have worked together in our lives to give us a born again experience. These two are most important in our spiritual life. So that's the reason here the prophet Elisha telling to the king of Israel that you have to take the bow and the arrow. So the first question we have to ask tonight is, am I having the bow in me, with me? Am I having the arrows with me? If you don't have, if you have left them in your spiritual life, this is the time for you to take the bow and the arrows with you, because they will help you to overcome the spiritual enemies and to see revival. So the second thing what the prophet is telling is, if we read verse 16, there the word of God says, and he said to the king of Israel, put thine hand upon the bow, and he put his hand upon it, and Elisha put his hands upon the king's hand. Now, not only the king of Israel was asked to take the bow and the arrows, now the prophet is telling him to lay his hand on the bow. And when he had laid, when the king of Israel had laid his hand on the bow, then the prophet has also laid his hand upon the king's hand. And that is the fellowship that we should have with the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. We must have fellowship with the Holy Spirit. Because Holy Spirit was sent to abide in us. Why did Jesus go away? Why did Jesus ascend to heaven? Because he wants to send the Holy Spirit so that he can dwell in us, so can he can dwell among us. So now the bow, which is the Holy Spirit, is abiding under the hand of the King of Israel. And now the prophet has also put his hand. So hand upon hand, that's the fellowship we should be having with the Holy Spirit. And that's what John writes in his letter. 1 John chapter 1 verses 7 says, "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin." We ask forgiveness for our sins. And we have to ask forgiveness when we sin. But here, the amazing truth is, when you have fellowship with God, when you walk in the light as he is the light, automatically the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse us, will make us holy, will get us right with God. That's the amazing blessing. If you're not a true believer, true Christian, you only pray for the forgiveness. You will not pray for the rest of the things. You will not pray for your spiritual life. You are only concerned about heaven and hell, not walk with God. But you must have the fellowship with the bow, the Holy Spirit. That's the second thing. The first thing is, take the bow, the Holy Spirit. Take the arrows, the word of God. And now the second thing is, you have to lay your hand upon the bow, the Holy Spirit. Then the prophet will also will lay his hand upon you, and that's where you enjoy the fellowship of God. And the third thing which we learn here is, if we read verse 17, the scripture says, "And he said, open the window eastward, and he opened it." So after laying his hand upon the bow, now the prophet is asking him to open the window which is on the east side. And this window is our heart. It's good to open our mouths to pray and to praise, but it is more important to open our hearts to praise God and to pray God. How are we worshiping Jesus? How are we praying to God? That's the question we have to ask ourselves. Are we just praising God? Because if we don't praise God, something will happen to us. Is that our motto? Is that why we are praising God? How are we praying? Are we just praying? Because if we don't pray and go out, some accident may happen. Is our understanding about prayer, that just asking God to keep us safe while we are going out, or asking God to keep his angels around us while we are sleeping? Those are the prayers which resembles the prayers that we just open our mouth to pray. But you have to have an open heart to pray according to his will and to his word. Remember Daniel? When the king signed that writing that no one should worship anyone for 30 days, what did he do? Daniel chapter 6 verse 10 says, now when Daniel knew that the king has signed the writing, he went into his house, and being his windows are opened in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime. He did not shut the windows. I don't know if he might have shut the windows, the people might not have seen him while he was praying or praising God. The people who saw Daniel was praying, the people who reported to the king that Daniel was praying might have seen through that window, but Daniel did not close the window, praise God. He opened the window, because if you open the window, that's when your prayers connect to God. That's when your praises go unto God. And that's the reason Daniel, though the king has signed upon the writing that no one should worship or bow down or pray to any god other than that king, and Daniel went to his room, and being his windows opened, he kneeled down upon his knees and prayed to God and praised his God. Are we opening our doors of hearts? Are our praises are going to God? Are our prayers are reaching God? If our hearts are shut, they may not go. And why did the prophet ask the king of Israel to open the windows? The next sentence in the same verse, verse 17, says, then Elisha said, shoot, and he shot. And he said, the arrow of the Lord's deliverance and the arrow of deliverance from Syria. For thou shalt smite the Syrians in Aphek till thou have consumed them. Now, he understood why the prophet wants to open the window. Because the prophet wanted the king of Israel to shoot an arrow through that window. And the king of Israel has done what exactly the prophet has told him. And the fourth spiritual thing that we learn from here is, we have already said that those arrows resemble the words of God. And we have to shoot the word of God in that window, which is our heart. Which means that we have to use the word of God to praise him. We have to use the word of God to pray him. And that's when that prayer will become the prayer of deliverance. Hallelujah. If you don't open the window and shoot the arrow, it may come back to you. But when you open the window of your heart and use the arrow of this word of God to praise him, to pray him, that's when that prayer will become the deliverance prayer. And that's when the prayer will become the prayer of healing. And that's when that prayer will become the prayer of prosperity. Praise God. Are we using the word of God in our worship? Are we using the word of God in our prayer? Many Christians just pray according to their wish. They think prayer is nothing but just telling their physical needs to God. No, the men of Bible have prayed spiritual prayers if we see the scriptures, the Holy Spirit has recorded the prayers of the saints. And King David prayed for his eyes, Lord, help me not to behold vanity. Help me not to set any wicked thing before mine eyes, because if I set any wicked thing before mine eyes, I may fall into sin. That's what happened when he was walking on the top of his kingdom. He saw a woman bathing, and that's when he committed sin. So now David is praying a spiritual prayer that, Lord, help me not to set any wicked thing before mine eyes. Have we prayed such prayers in our spiritual lives? We pray for the things that we see. Lord, give me that, give me this. Of course, I'm not telling that you should not pray for your needs. Of course, you can pray. But what about your spiritual life? David prayed, and the man of God prayed for their mouth and tongues and lips and ears and hearts and minds, legs and feet and hands. My dad was delivered from demons by reading the Word of God. He was a Hindu devotee. In his teenage, he was possessed with demons. So he visited all Hindu temples. But finally, the word that he got from the priest is that it is his karma and he has to suffer, and there is no remedy for him in this life at all. So he addicted to all bad habits because he doesn't have any hope. There is no hope in what he trusts. But one day one of his friends told him that Jesus can deliver you from those demons. But he simply rejected it because we have a million gods, and why should I worship Jesus? But that night, Jesus appeared to him and said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. He was surprised and went and told to his friend next day. And his friend gave him a New Testament Bible to read, because what he heard was from this Bible. When he started to read the Bible, the demons within him could not stay. Praise God. So that's when he knew there is power in this word. So whenever the demons used to come, he used to read the Bible. But at that time, my grandmother, my dad's mother, was a Hindu. So she would not allow him to switch on the light in the middle of the night to read the Bible. But she threw the Bible out of the house. So then the Holy Spirit gave him an idea to keep God's word in his heart. So he started memorizing God's word. So whenever the demons used to come, he used to recite those scriptures, and the demons used to leave him. So by the grace of God, today he has memorized over 5,000 scriptures from the Holy Bible. And he taught us same, and I taught same to my children. And we have a ministry that encourages people to memorize the Word of God. And by the grace of God, I have memorized over 200 scriptures. And recently I completed memorizing the whole book of Revelation, all 22 chapters, in English language, King James Version. And we not only memorize them, but we recite them every day. That's how we spend time with God and the Holy Spirit. And every day it takes me around 3 to 5 hours to recite the verses that I have memorized. As I recite them, I worship God with His Word. And I pray God according to His Word. And that's way I enjoy the fellowship of Holy Spirit. And that practice has, in fact, helped me to write a couple of books on prayer and worship. I hope everyone has received them. Please go through them. A book on worship tells you how you can worship God using this word. A book on prayer tells you how to pray according to His word, using the scripture. Why did God send the Holy Spirit? Jesus told in John Gospel chapter 16, the Spirit of truth is sent so that He will lead us unto all the truth. Hallelujah. What is truth? The Word of God is truth. Jesus said that in John 17:17. He was in fact praying for His disciples. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. The Holy Spirit wants us to lead unto scriptures. And when we use the scriptures to pray, to worship God, and here the prophet is telling, when the king has put arrow into the window, now he is telling, this is the arrow of deliverance. If you need deliverance tonight, if you need healing tonight, if you need blessing tonight, if you need anything in your life, you have to use the scripture and pray and praise God. And that will become the arrow that you want. So the fifth spiritual truth that we learn here is, was found in verse 18. And he said, take the arrows. And he took them. So the fifth truth is, not only we use these arrows in our prayer and in our worship, but we have to keep, have, hold these arrows in our hands. Are we having the arrows in our hands? I know there are still hundreds of tribes and people groups who doesn't have this Bible in their own language. But how much we are blessed in this world that we have been given an opportunity to have this living Word of God, the spoken word of the Holy Spirit, right in our hands. Are we holding it? Apostle Paul says to the church in Philippines, chapter 2, verses 15 and 16, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. Holding forth the word of life. Apostle Paul is telling to the believers in the church in Philippines that you have to hold the word of the light, because when you hold it, when you have the word of God in your hands, the light will spread the world, because the world that we are living in is darkened by Satan. So the people are not able to see God. They were blinded by the devil. But if you can hold this light of Word of God, it will shine in and through you, so that the people around you can see you and know who God is. If you want to see revival, you have to be the light. You have to impact the lives that are around you. Why did God save you? It's not just because that He doesn't want you to go into hell. Of course, we are saved to go to heaven. But the main other purpose is, we have to be a vessel of God to save other people from going to hell. Are we impacting the lives around us? To impact the people that are living around you. You have to take the word of light. Let this light shine within you and from you, so that the world around you can see you. That's the fifth lesson. I'm glad the king was able to do all the things that this prophet is telling him. But the important thing is the sixth lesson. Let's read the same verse, 18. And he said unto the king of Israel, smite upon the ground, and he smote thrice and stayed. Now the king is telling him, O king of Israel, you have done all what I have told you. You have taken the bow, you have taken the arrows, and you have laid your hand upon the bow as I told you. You have opened the window, and you have put the arrow in the window, and you have taken the arrows into your hands. And now you have to smite the arrows on the ground. And the king was able to do only three times. He was only able to shoot the arrows on the ground for three times. And our topic, I hope you remember it. Smite the arrows on the ground to see the revival. And the ground is our heart. We have to smite the arrows, which is the word of God, on our hearts. When you smite the arrows on the ground, and the arrows will go into it. And when you smite the arrows of this word on your heart, the word of God will go inside of your heart. Are we smiting the arrows on the ground? Are we smiting the word of God into our hearts? How many times are we smiting? I know every Christian church has a policy, or has a method, or has a curriculum in their churches that the Sunday school children has to memorize certain Bible verses. I hope your church must be having that too. We encourage children to memorize the word of God, which is good. Of course, we are called to do that. And I'm glad that every church has that curriculum or that policy in their churches that they are helping kids to keep God's word in their hearts. But my question tonight is, why are we not doing that when we become the elders? Why did we stop keeping God's word? Why did we stop memorizing the scriptures? Yes, we were taught to keep God's word in our hearts while we went to Sunday school. We forced our children to memorize God's word. But why did we stop memorizing the scriptures when we are grown up? Have you ever thought of that? Some way the devil has blinded us. Some way the old serpent has blinded us. But to get victory over that, we need to smite the word of God on the ground. And the conclusion of the message is the seventh spiritual truth. We have to smite the arrows upon the ground without stopping. When we stop smiting, we will lose the victory. See, if we read the last verse, there the prophet says in verse 19, and the man of God was wroth with him and said, those shouldest have smitten five or six times. Then hadst thou smitten Syria till thou hadst consumed it, where as now those shall smite Syria but thrice. Because you have smitten three times, you have only victory three times over Syrians. If you would have smitten five or six times or even more, you would have got victory over them completely. But because you have stopped smiting, now the victory is limited to you. How true it is in our spiritual walk. Why are we yet struggling with sin? Why are we yet crumbling? Why are we falling down every time? We know Christ died for us. We know He has brought victory to us. But why are we failing in our walk with God? Why are we still falling down in our spiritual walk with God? Why are we not able to get victory over this world, over the desires of this world, over the desires of our old nature, over the tactics of the old serpents? Why are we apt struggling with those things? Because we could only smite the arrows for a certain time or certain times. So that's the reason we are having only victories over certain things. And yet we are struggling with other things. And what is the solution for this? And why did the king of Israel only could smite three times? Remember, he has the arrows. They were in his hand because he has taken the arrows, but only he smote three times. Because I think the ground is very hard. If the ground is wet, the arrows will go into the ground. But if it is hard, the arrows will come back to you. I believe that's the reason the king of Israel could only smite three times. The first one might have gone into the ground. The second one might have gone a little bit. And the third one seemed to be that it could come back. So that's the reason he did not try the fourth one. It may come back to him. Why are Christians today are not able to keep God's word in their hearts? Because their hearts are hardened. That's the reason they are not able to smite the arrows upon the ground. And what is the solution for this? How do we make our hearts? How do we make our grounds wet so that the arrows can go into them? And the good thing and the good news is, like I said, Jesus has sent the Holy Spirit for us. If we can pour out the water of the Holy Spirit upon our hearts, the grounds, and that water of the Holy Spirit will make our ground wet. Hallelujah. When our hearts are made wet, when the ground is made wet, the hard ground will become the soft ground. The hard ground will become the wet ground. Upon the wet ground, you can smite the arrows, so the arrows will go into the heart. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to pour out His water of life upon our hardened hearts, so that our hardened hearts will become wet by the water of the Holy Spirit and make our hardened hearts into smooth hearts, so that the arrows will go into our hearts. The more arrows we put into the ground, the more victorious life we have in our lives. And that is revival. When you have a victorious life, when you are not caught by any sin of this world, any sin of your old nature, any sin of old serpent. And that is revival. When you are revived, your life will revive the people around you. May the Lord help us to smite arrows upon the ground of our hearts so that we can be revived and live a victorious life and help others to see Christ in us and they may be revived as well. God bless you. Thank you.